Hello guys, welcome back to our macroeconomic session. Now yesterday we saw current account and its components. Today we will see what does the balance of current account mean in the calculation or the tallying of your balance of payment, and then we will study in depth the capital account of BOP. Now first thing that I'm going to tell you to remember is whenever you write BOP in the abbreviation form, you have to write it like this. B small O and capital P. In anything which includes conjunctions or you can say some helping verbs, these things are written in small forms. When you say balance of payment, the of O is small, okay, BOP. So we studied current account and its elements, right? Like the first and foremost thing that we consider in current account is that of trade account. So what is the trade balance? When you say trade account, you are well aware that we talk about import and export only of the goods. So it is very simple that in trade account, the balance, the trade balance, that is the first element in considering your current account, consists of trade surplus or trade deficit. Now what is meant by trade surplus and trade deficit? When you consider that there are only two things which define your trade account, that is the export of goods or the import of goods. So when the export of goods are greater than the import of goods, it means what? The foreign currency that is coming in your country is more than the foreign currency that goes out of your country. So definitely it is the trade surplus. So you can say in case of trade surplus, the export as denoted by X, we know this by now, right? So when X is greater than M, you will have a trade surplus and obviously it will have a positive balance. But when the exports are less and the imports are more, can this be possible? Yes, of course. When your products, the products that are produced in the domestic country, in the home country, are having less demand in the foreign market, the exports will be less. But I think especially in India, we are more keen on, you know, bringing in the foreign products. So the imports are greater, so that is the trade deficit. We will come to understanding the implications of these kinds of deficits later, but you just have a clear idea. When you say that the trade balance is negative, you mean that there is a trade deficit, means your imports are greater than your export. Now this import and export are of trade account, means you are talking only about goods, okay? And the remaining invisible trade and the transfer payments, what are these? Now in this, for the current account, what you have to understand that for a current account balance, for this current account balance, if the receipts are greater than the payments, you have a positive balance. Now you cannot say current account surplus or current account deficit, but you can say a positive balance or a negative balance. But of course, back of the mind, you know that when there is a positive current account balance, it means it is nothing but surplus. When the receipts are greater than the payments that you make, now these receipts and payments are all of the balance of payment, means these all things are considered in foreign exchange. The forex that you consider, the transactions or the movements of your goods and services which cross the boundaries, these international transactions, receipts, if they are greater than the payments that you make for these transactions, then you will have a positive balance. Means there is a surplus in current account. And on the contrary, if you have the receipts are less than the payments, of course you know that our outflow is more, it is a negative balance, means here you can see lot and lot of outflow. Outflow is greater than the inflow of foreign exchange, correct? So this is the main balance. So you cannot say that if there is a trade surplus, the current account will also have trade surplus. It's not possible. But for considering the current account and the balance of current account, what we do is, first element is what we consider is the trade balance, and then we consider the receipts and payments of remaining two things, that is the transfer payment and the invisible trade. So when three of these things are combined and still the summation of these three things reveal that the receipts or the foreign exchange that entered our country are more than what left our country, means what was the outflow was less and inflow was greater, you are talking about the positive balance of current account. And if the case is different from the existing, means the payments are greater and the receipts are lower, then your current account gives you a negative balance. That means it shows you deficit. Okay, so this is all about current account so far that you need to learn. Implications, of course, we'll study in the later or further sessions. Okay, so today we are going to start with one of the most important part practically that you are going to require to understand how macroeconomic works in the current environment. It is the capital account. Now, like I told you in the previous lecture, that when you talk about capital account, you are obviously talking about the assets and liabilities stuff. So capital account records all those transactions which affect the assets and liabilities of the government or of the businesses of a country, means in short the whole economy, right? So the basic three things that are the part of capital account are, first is the investment, second is the external borrowings. Now specifically here we are using the word external because we are talking about balance of payment. Now we have studied in the fiscal deficit that the borrowings that you can have can be from your home country, means the RBI also, and also from the rest of the world. So the rest of the world that you are talking about is your component of external borrowing, forming a part of your capital account. And third component is that of your external assistance. External assistance. Now we will see one by one what all these things mean. Now in some of the reference books or maybe in your textbook or online notes that you refer, you can see various subsectors of this capital account. Like I have divided this in three parts. You might find in two parts. One part may be talking about borrowing, other may be talking about assistance. But these all things taken together, you will understand that basically it talks about, first is the investment that you make in the rest of the world or the foreign countries make in your country. Second is the borrowings that you can borrow, you can take from the rest of the world, or you can advance to the rest of the world. And then the assistance, like we saw in transfer payments. Transfer payments were small payments, remittances, gifts and grants. But when we take these transfer payments to a larger sector, and then you have a certain obligation of repayment. Even if somebody is helping you out in a financial crunch situation, but you are bound to repay them, then that situation comes under external assistance. Assistance is nothing but your help, right? So when you have to differentiate between the transfer payment and the external assistance, what you have to remember is transfer payments are, like I said to you in the previous session, are unilateral. They are one-sided payments without having any obligation upon you to repay them. But in case of assistance, they are bound to repay, but the concession in the interest rate is taken into consideration. Now let's move to understand what are these specific sectors that are forming a part of your capital account of BOP. First is your direct investment. In case of investments, I think now you are well aware what are investments. Investment means when you invest your money, your capital in certain business. So when you talk about balance of payments, this investment is broadly classified into direct investment and portfolio investment. Now when you hear this word direct investment, you obviously know we are talking about the one of the most important part of our economy, that is the FDI. Now what is FDI? FDI stands for foreign direct investment. I think we have studied or gone through this FDI and FIIs in your previous sessions also. So macroeconomics deals with whatever economy does the transaction, residents do the transaction with rest of the world. So FDI means the investment that are made directly into the business of any country. For example, Walmart, those people are opening their businesses in our country. So that gives them the power or the control over that specific business. That is called as FDI. The name specifically, if you break this term down, you will understand FDI. Foreign means the rest of the world, direct investment. They invest their money directly into some business in India, which gives them the control or which gives them the power to take decisions regarding the operations of this business. That is called as FDI. And this direct investment is not only confined to FDI, it also includes other investments which are done in order to have the control over the business. Another one is the portfolio investment. What do you mean by portfolio? Portfolio is nothing but the securities of a particular business. You invest in the securities. Means you become the shareholders, the bondholders, the debenture holders, these people who have interest in the future running of the company. Correct? That is the portfolio investment. So portfolio investment includes something that you called as FII. Or offshore funding. FII stands for foreign institutional investment. Means you do not invest in the business directly. What you do is invest in the securities of the business so that you don't have the control. The control is not given to you, but then what happens is that you can earn interest and dividends on the shares and securities that you buy. So the basic difference between these two things are that there is the difference of control or the power. So when you talk about portfolio investment, it means you are going international, right? Now in trade account, we have understood that the goods, and in invisible trade, we have understood that the services can cross the boundaries. But here what you are doing is you are inviting the offshore funding. You are inviting the foreigners to be a part of your management. That is your FII. You are allowed, your shares are listed on international stock exchanges as well, and people can come and, you know, invest in that. So that becomes your portfolio investment, where not only the domestic people or domestic institutions are allowed to purchase your shares, but also the offshore funding takes place. That is your in all investment, which forms a part of your capital account. Correct? Now this is the investment which we are talking about private agencies, the non-government agencies, correct? These are the private businesses that we are talking about. But when you talk about external borrowings, the next part, the external borrowings also refer to the borrowings that not only the businesses take, but also the government and government related agencies take. Now when you talk about borrowings, you know what this word indicates. Where there is a borrowing, there is an obligation. Where there is the borrowing money coming in, there is also some interest obligation that you have to repay. Even if the borrowing means that you are getting the money right now, but then it also comes with a future burden. That burden is what? Of not only repaying the principal, but also the interest factor. And when you calculate, I think in the future time you will calculate or study the financial management, in that you will understand that when you are repaying a particular loan, at the end of the repayment you will realize that the principal section that you are repaying is less and the interest part is major. So when you talk about external, you mean you are talking about rest of the world. And when you are talking about borrowings, you know these are money that come with an obligation of interest. So interest payment. Now these interest on external borrowings are the interest rate that are existing in the market. No concession is taken place when you are talking about specifically the borrowings. Now say you are a business operating within the domestic territory of India. So what you will do is you will borrow from the commercial banks. So commercial banks are not going to give you any kind of concession. Similarly, when you talk about the entire economy, the macroeconomics means the government's point of view, if the government wants to borrow money from some other country, that will mean that they are resorting to the external borrowings and they will have to pay certain interest payments. And that interest payment, I think we saw in the current account that those interest payments are also your current or revenue nature. So that interest payment are the obligations of what you borrow. So these external borrowings can mean short-term debt from any country, or you can say government and rest of the world borrowings. And most importantly, we know World Bank finance. These are the types or these are the things that we include in the external borrowing section, correct? Moving forward, when you talk about external assistance, I think right now in this era of the pandemic that has been spread for more than 3-4 months now, I think. So external assistance is the most important element which all the countries are hanging on to, right? We saw the case of Italy. What happened there is that people were, you know, more people were dead than alive and they had no money. They had to surrender themselves to WHO. Why was this? Because the resources that they had were insufficient. And the money that they have is also insufficient to undertake more treatments or, you know, bring in more resources. At this time, what you're going to do is you have two options. Either you borrow or somebody assists you. Now borrowing also up to a limit, you can understand, up to a limit only you can borrow. You cannot go on just borrowing for the sake of it. You also have to see how much is your earning capacity, what the future beholds. And we know that this is such an uncertain time that no other country is going to give you as much as you want. No other country is going to lend you without a promise of repayment. So what happens is, if you resort to external assistance, means the help. Now again, this external assistance can come from various countries, the World Bank, the central banks of various countries, right? So this external assistance, one important thing that you have to understand is this has the concession on interest rates. When you talk about assistance, you say assistance means this has a concession on interest rate. This is a lower interest charges, lower interest rate than your market interest, correct? So external assistance is also given at the time when some countries, you know, just beginning to develop from underdeveloped to developing stage. When a country is in the developing stage, many countries give you the external assistance in terms of funds, which help you to not only, you know, survive, but also they help you in growing. So not only in terms of crisis, but also when you are going into some innovative production line, you have the external assistance. And also you have to remember, when you talk about external assistance, the same thing goes for borrowing, that there is an obligation of repayment. You have to repay, but then the interest rate is very low. Okay, so here external assistance is nothing but help. This is help, but you have to repay it. Repayment is must. The interest might be lower, but the repayment is must. So this is in all what the capital account consists of, right? Now, having understood these things about capital account, now we need to understand what are the implications. So how do you decide the capital account? How do you understand that what the capital account wants to show you? If for a country, if you identify these three things, if you identify the transaction and post this into three things, you categorize the transaction into these three major broad categories. So what does it show you? So let me tell you, when you are talking about investment or the external assistance or the external borrowings, all these three things again come in the purview of net. When you have to calculate how much investment is the foreign country making in your country, you also have to deduct the amount of investment that your country has made in the foreign country. So both these FDI and FIIs, when you put in the capital account, you have to keep in mind that the figures that show in the balance of payment are the net figures, correct? So in capital account, again, what you have is the debit side and the credit side. But I think having understood all this, you have now understood that when there is an obligation, your liability increases. When I'm telling you as an individual that you need to borrow from someone, so you immediately in the back of your mind, what do you think is, oh God, my liability is going to increase. Means what is happening? Liability is your credit side. So whenever money comes in with the obligation, it becomes your liability, and liability gives rise to the credit side. So liability is credit. So borrowings or the assistance that come to your country are the credit side, and the other things are the debit side. Whatever outflow you are going to make is the debit side, and whatever inflow that you are going to do is the credit side, correct? When you say outflow and inflow, you don't have to resort to the rules of real account, debit what comes in and credit what goes out. No, you have to think about how does it impact your balance of payment. When you say credit, means somebody is giving it to you, the investment that are made in your country or the external assistance that you have got is your credit, because it gives a rise to the liability, correct? So when I say repayment of loans from foreign country, means you have given loans to the countries, what does it mean? Loans and advances given. These are the asset side, right, for a trader. Similarly, for balance of payment, loans and advances are debits, right? So when they repay it, what happens? Credit. Similarly, when we take these borrowings, what happens? The external assistance comes in, the money comes in, so it forms the credit side of your capital account. Now this, obviously, with the transactions we are going to study further in detail, but you have to understand that for a balance of payment to tally, the total of capital account, current account and capital account should be equal to zero. Like in accounts paper, you are always worrying about tallying the balance sheet. If the balance sheet get tallied, you are like super happy. Same. Here the balance means you have to just ensure that the total comes up to zero. Now why is this total coming up to zero? It means that your balance of payments, your transactions with the rest of the world are equal, are in the balance. So you have to remember that the current account and the capital account summation will always come to zero. So even if you find that the receipts are less than the payments and they are negative balance, so negative balance in current account has to be sufficed by what? Positive balance of your capital account. So if you have negative 5 in the capital account, you need to have positive 5 so that the balance comes to zero, correct? So when you talk about capital account in terms of debit and credit transaction, what you have to remember is when you are taking borrowings from the country, then those are the credit side, and credit side is the positive side and debit side is your negative side. Debit side is your negative when you are repaying, and credit side is your positive when you are either borrowing or somebody from the rest of the world is repaying you the loans that you in the first place advanced to them. Now, in terms of this entire two elements that we saw, current account and capital account, the most practical approach that you can see in current times is that of this sector, means the capital account. So I'll just leave you there with understanding all these concepts. So you better make proper notes, and you also see the publications that are given by the World Bank or the RBI for current time, so that you understand the impact of these external borrowings. Okay. So in the next lecture, we are going to see how do these elements come together to form the balance of payment ending. How do you determine that what these transactions mean for a country? What position do balance of payment determine for our country in terms of the world economy? Okay, thank you.